concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing anything. My eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
Worldwide show here on WSHO Sunshine 800 AM. Welcome to the program. I am your host, Trey Roberts. Glad you are joining us from wherever you are listening and or watching the program. Yes, you can watch us if you are on YouTube, Facebook, or Twitter. Just type in Kingdom Useful or The Rock Worldwide Show, and you can watch us there. You can comment there as well, like my buddy here, Kenneth Cochran, also known as K Black. K Black says, "What's up, Trey?" So he's already in the building, so you can do that there. You can also go to WSHO.com and scroll down to the chat room, like I'm about to do right now. I always seem to forget to do this, but nevertheless, going to jump in. Scroll down, and you'll see a chat room there, and you can put your name in, like I'm doing right now, Trey. And I'm in there. And then refresh the page. At least that's what I have to do. And there's a couple folks in there. Bobby and SG, they're in there. Welcome, welcome. Glad you're with us. So we are rip-roaring ready to go. And, of course, if you want to be a part of the program, you can give us a call at 504-527-0800. Okay. So where do we want to start? I mean, we can start anywhere. There's so much going on. So many people. Very much, I know this audience is very aware, super, super aware, by the way, of all of the things going on right now in terms of just kind of the culture. When you think about what's going on in the culture right now, to me, the biggest news, you know, we're told that the Supreme Court is a non-political body, right? We're told that they are the arbiters of what is and is not constitutional. They're supposed to basically call balls and strikes. They're just supposed to say, hey, this law that has been passed by the legislative branch and signed into law, being enforced by the executive branch, we are interpreting that law as being constitutional or not being constitutional. And of course, like most of our government over time, which is part of the system, it has evolved, it has grown, it has changed, it has adapted to the times. And although there are some core principles by which we follow in the United States of America, the Constitution has over time given us opportunities to change our core principles as written in the Constitution, known as the amendment process. And of course, there's been 27 of those, I believe, 27 amendments. The first 10 of those came almost immediately upon the adoption of the Constitution, known as the Bill of Rights. And as Barack Obama correctly articulated, that the Bill of Rights is a charter of negative liberties. It is a series of things that the federal government cannot do, but it does not actually say what the federal government can or should do beyond those things, unless you're a strict 10th Amendment person, which says that anything not specifically explicitly enumerated in the Constitution or these Bill of Rights, all of the additional rights and privileges shall be reserved for the states and for the people. Unfortunately, the 10th Amendment seems to have been forgotten. The 10th Amendment seems to have been overrun. And the amendments that came afterwards, many of which came after the Civil War, as well as in the progressive era of the early 1900s, the early 20th century, those have seemingly overtaken or become more important than the rights. And they're just as constitutional because they are part of the amendments to the Constitution. I bring all that up to say that Supreme Court Justice Breyer, the 83-year-old from San Francisco, sort of an old-school liberal, I wouldn't call Breyer a woke liberal. He's no Sotomayor. He's no Elena Kagan. And he's kind of cut the same cut of the jib, if you will, maybe a little bit less liberal than the late, great, notorious RBG, Ruth Bader Ginsburg. But he is, who was, by the way, nominated by Bill Clinton in 1994. Looks like he's hanging up his gown, so he's out. And so that looks like Joe Biden will be able to. Now, this is what's interesting. Joe Biden's going to nominate Justice Breyer, and Justice Breyer is not going to retire until after the current Supreme Court session, which doesn't end until like June, July-ish of this year. So that means that the Senate that holds the power to be able to confirm or deny the president's nominee is not going to really take up the issue at least until July, probably August. And we have midterms coming up in November. So you've got August, September, October. You've got 90 days, basically. And right now, the Senate is basically a 50-50 split. Now, I don't think Sinema and I don't think Manchin are going to vote with the Republicans so that the Republicans basically have a 52-50 majority. And because the Democrats have not gotten rid of the filibuster yet, I don't think that they're going to also vote with the Republicans to continue a filibuster should the nominee put forth by President Biden be some crazy radical. The one scenario that really, really, really intrigues me, almost more than any other one, is if Joe Biden nominates Kamala Harris to be his next Supreme Court justice. When he was stumping for the president, he said that he would nominate a black woman should a vacancy on the Supreme Court come. It is time for a black woman to become a Supreme Court justice. We've had black people. We've had female people. We've just not had black female people. And so he says it's time. It's their turn. I don't even know what that means. I guess there's a waiting list. I don't know. That seems weird to me. I don't know what a person's melanation or their lack thereof has to do with their jurisprudence or legal theory. But of course, all things in the Democrat Party and the progressive uber left, everything is about identity and color of skin and all of that stuff. So, what happens if there's a 50-50 vote in the Senate to confirm Kamala Harris? This is why this intrigues me. Who currently breaks the tie? That's right. Thank you for playing along. And those of you who took my civics class in between the election and inauguration of this past year. That's right. The Vice President of the United States. So guess what that means? That means that Kamala Harris, and there's nothing in the Constitution that says she can't do this, Kamala Harris may be the deciding vote for her nomination to the Supreme Court. You cannot make this stuff up. Now, the only hope is that Biden nominates someone so radical. I mean, so woke, like AOC or the chick who started Black Lives Matter, like somebody somebody really radical that even the Democrats are like, whoa. Like, if you remember, George W. Bush nominated his personal lawyer. What's her name? Harriet Tubman or Harriet Myers. Harriet Myers. And even Republicans were like, dude, she like notarizes your foundation documents. This woman cannot be a Supreme. Like, she was completely not allowed to be even considered to be on the Supreme Court. Okay. We have to hope for something that bad. Here's why we have to hope for that. Because if, as many pundits believe now, and recent history has shown, these pundits recently, have been wrong. So wrong. But all indications right now seem to be that the momentum is on the Republican side, and it looks like the Republican Congress, both in the Senate and in the House, they're going to take a shellacking. So if by some chance Mitch McConnell, with his genius rules of the Senate, this is what he's known for. He's known for being a genius in the Senate. If he is really able to prevent Joe Biden's nominee from becoming confirmed, and the Republicans take the Senate, we could see a situation where Joe Biden is forced to nominate someone like a classical liberal, someone who's still center left, because he or she is being nominated by a Democrat president. But we may be able to stave off a radical, leftist, woke type of nominee. But the Kamala Harris thing is quite interesting to me. And then, of course, we've got some studies that are out right now. A new study on pre-K, comprehensive, but it's devastating. This new study finds that free state pre-K programs can actually make children perform worse. There's been a lot of hope that pre-K programs could actually help children, especially kids from poor and minority communities, and this includes things like Head Start programs. But for years, the data behind the federal, the public funding of these programs has been quite questionable. And no study has been as comprehensive as this one recently that came out that randomly assigned about 3,000 kids in Tennessee to attend pre-K and followed them through the sixth grade. Here's what it found. Children in state-sponsored pre-K had worse grades and more disciplinary problems, with one caveat. There's some indication that Tennessee's pre-K programs have been uniquely lagging. And one theory as to why these pre-K programs could be hurting children is the facility seemed to stress out young children. And we're talking about children younger than 36 months old. Children who are less than 3 years old, like, they don't do well emotionally when demand is placed on them. The way that young children, and this has been known for a long time, I remember this as a school teacher, my first degree is in education. I remember this in educational psychology and child development and a lot of the educational theories classes, but it was taught to us that young kids learn best in play scenarios, and nobody feels really stressed out when they're playing around, when they're goofing around, having fun. And so when you put this kind of stress on young children, especially children younger than the age of 3 years, the stress alone seems to do something to their psychological, to their psyche development that causes them to act out emotionally because they don't have the tools necessary, it seems, according to this new study. And so this would indicate that kids, and it's not surprising to myself or people like me who homeschool their children or who believe that children are best served in the home with their parents, in the home of origin with two-parent family, like it's a stable nuclear. This is a big piece of evidence for those who believe in the intact nuclear family, unlike a lot of the modern woke movements that say it doesn't really matter. So, and by the way, I will post all the links to all of these in the show notes. later after the program. As if we didn't know, COVID is the new normal. Doctors are, we're seeing the COVID numbers that are still pretty high this week. But the risk of serious illness right now remains vanishingly low for the vaccinated. And I know a lot of you are going to jump in the chat room or sitting there right now. Listen, I am personally, I like to disclose this because I think it's important to be honest. I just try to be honest in the information so you know kind of where I'm coming from. I am personally double vaxxed and boosted, and I have never had COVID. I was a part of three studies with three local hospitals and universities here that was testing me on a regular basis before I got vaccinated, before I got the first vaccination. For antibodies. So I've been trying to do my part to like understand and learn about how all this stuff works. And I just say that to say that I'm also against mandates. I'm against mandates from government, from every level of government, whether it is federal, state, or local. I'm against mandates by employers. So I'm 100% against anyone forcing anyone to inject something into their body that they don't want injected into their body. I support your right to not, and I defend your right, and I stand by you in the fight to not force you to take the vaccine, okay? Anybody who doesn't, for whatever reason, even if it's a reason I don't agree with, I support your right and defend your right to not take the vaccine. Just please don't hate on me because I think it's safe and effective, and I took it, okay? Two things can be true at the same time. I just try to be honest, and I just try to get you to think well about things. This doesn't have to be an either-or fallacy. This isn't, oh, it's bad because they're mandating it. It also doesn't have to be because there's so much anecdotal information. Somebody told me the other day, yeah, man, thousands of people are dying around the world. Okay, well, what is thousands? What is that number? Are we talking about 1,000? Are we talking about 100,000? Are we talking about 900,000? Right? Because, look, if at this point hundreds of millions of people around the world are fully vaccinated, and if we're talking about we're approaching 3 billion people on planet Earth who have at least received one dose of the vaccine, please do understand basic math. If 999,999 people have had adverse reactions up to and including death, that is still an incredibly low rate of adverse reaction considering how many people have been vaccinated. So again, two things can be true. There's a lot of people who can be dying because of adverse reactions to the vaccine. And at the same time, it can be so small that the risk is not enough to take the vaccines off of the market because we have now 2+ years of data going all the way back to trials, 30 years of studying mRNA vaccines, and we now have information enough to know, and there is enough data. So like, don't give me the whole, there's not enough data, it's still too new, we don't know the long-term effects. That's the only thing that I agree with you with on those who are vaccine hesitant. And again, I understand you being vaccine hesitant. And I believe that you have a right to be, because our public health officials have completely screwed the pooch on this one in their messaging, in their mandating, in they should, listen, if you know anything about the nature of human beings, you tell them they have to do something and they're gonna push back against it. So it was just dumb on their part. But you need to be wise as a serpent and gentle as a dove and realize that although these people who are godless don't understand the importance of operating in wisdom, you need to understand that the mandate to do it, there is a possibility that some people believe that it's good to do and that government has the right to do that. What we need to understand is government doesn't have the authority to do that, and make the argument for the mandate to go away, as it has. The Supreme Court has basically struck it down. And then what we need to do is we also need to know where our sources, where there are good sources of information from medical professionals who have access to the data, that at this point there have been thousands of studies that have been published in reputable journals, medical journals, and these, there are people who aggregate all of these particular studies. And you need to be mindful of the people who have a bias. Just if you recognize their bias, you're able to take their information and filter it, and not receive everyone who just simply seems to be one particular type of way. Now, the vaccine, Tucker Carlson hosted, many of you I know probably follow this gentleman on Twitter or on social media, Alex Berenson. He's a prominent vaccine skeptic that was on his show this week. And Berenson told Tucker Carlson, largely older and vulnerable viewership. Remember, Fox's viewership is usually a much older viewership. The conservative audience is a little bit of an older audience, which means they're a little bit more of a vulnerable viewership. But this is what he said he told Tucker. The mRNA vaccine needs to be withdrawn from the market. No one should get them. No one should get boosted. No one should get double boosted, close quote. Unvaccinated people are some 20 times more likely to die of COVID than the vaccinated. It's really sad that Tucker Carlson would feed this to his highly loyal viewers, especially given that he is surely vaccinated himself. So that is something to be considered. If Tucker Carlson's not vaccinated, that's one thing. If he is vaccinated, and most of the elderly that watch the Tucker Carlson program are being told that these vaccines need to be withdrawn from the market, that's an unfortunate thing. And you say, well, Trey, where are you getting this idea of the 20 times more likely to die from COVID than the unvaccinated? And there's a Texas government study found that unvaccinated people were 20 times more likely to die of COVID than the fully vaccinated throughout most of September, providing further evidence backing the vaccines. The research published in the Texas Department of State Health Services on Monday determined that 81.3% of COVID-19 related deaths between September 4th and October 1st occurred among unvaccinated people. In comparison, 5% of these fatalities occurred among the partially vaccinated, and 13.7% involved fully vaccinated patients. In that period of time, unvaccinated individuals in their 40s were 55 times more likely to die from COVID-19 than others who were the same age and fully vaccinated. And among those aged 75 and older, the unvaccinated were 12 times more likely to die. Unvaccinated people were also 13 times more likely to contract COVID-19 than those who were fully vaccinated. More than 7 in 10 infected people were unvaccinated, compared to 19.3% who were partially vaccinated and 8.4% who were fully vaccinated. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this is not from the California Department of Health. This is not from the Governor Cuomo New York Department of Health. This is from Texas. This data out of Texas, it actually aligns with previous research that proves that the vaccine's effectiveness against the virus, including from the centers of the CDC, and the data, it aggregates quite well. Texas Governor Greg Abbott, a Republican, banned all COVID-19 vaccine mandates. Good job. I agree with that. That's great. Good job, Governor Abbott. So he banned the mandates last month. And then the governor issued an executive order after the Biden administration announced a rule for business with at least 100 employees to require vaccines or regular testing for their employees. So Texas is doing a good job. They're fighting it, although they have the data that shows that it is effective. This is why I took it, because it's safe and effective with all of the data that we have. Now, as we continue, J.D. Vance this week celebrated his endorsement from Marjorie Taylor Greene. I know many of you know who Marjorie Taylor Greene is. And Marjorie Taylor Greene, she's the congresswoman who has supported QAnon, and she thinks wildfires come from Jewish space lasers. That Marjorie Taylor Greene, basically J.D. Vance, who was catapulted to fame by writing a critically acclaimed memoir about growing up in poor rural America, said he planned to win this thing and take back the country from the scumbags. Vance is a smart guy, and he could have succeeded without embracing the lunatic fringe. And I would encourage you out there to not embrace the lunatic fringe, especially if you're a follower of Jesus. More evidence came out this week about the lab leak. There was a new City Journal investigation that looked at the recent unearthed emails from the start of the pandemic between some of the nation's top virologists. In the exchange, the scientists basically agreed that this looks very much like it came from a lab. Then they have a teleconference. Quote, what happened at the February 1 teleconference to make the virologists change their minds so radically? It was impossible to tell from the emails released in June 2021 because almost every word in them was redacted. Close quote. After that, the message from these experts is singular. The coronavirus came from nature. Author Nicholas Wade explains one potential reason for suppressing the origin story. Quote, Collins and Fauci could share a portion of the blame for having funded gain-of-function research despite its obvious risks, and then failing to ensure that grant recipients were taking all necessary precautions. Now, if this is true, if the idea that Dr. Francis Collins, who, by the way, is a great friend of scholar N.T. Wright, who is one of the foremost New Testament scholars of our current generation. So I trust Dr. Francis Collins. He's also the gentleman who did the Human Genome Project. He was the head of the Human Genome Project, but he is not a virologist. So I'm not making a plea to an expert here. But if they didn't follow up because Fauci and Collins turned on the funding again during the Trump administration, and the Trump administration didn't have the experts in place to know that this was not good, because during the Obama administration, they turned off the funding for this gain-of-function research. Fauci and Collins did this on their own. There can be no argument to that point. So they should be held responsible, especially if they turned it back on, and then, after turning it back on, they kind of stayed hands off because they didn't want it to be known that they turned it back on, because this would have been controversial. So this doesn't look good for Collins and Fauci. And I'm not so much worried about Fauci. He's done too much already to not get my support. But for Dr. Francis Collins, I'm sort of endeared to him a little bit. So it makes a difference. Let's go to the phone lines and go to line one. Line one, welcome to the Rock World Wide Show.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Oh, hey. I noticed, look, I don't really know Marjorie Taylor Greene that much. I would like to hear the quote. I mean, like, I don't know, you call her a lunatic. Like, the definition of a lunatic is somebody that's, like, demon-possessed or, like, mad. Like, people would call you a lunatic if you said, you know, okay, the virus was created in a lab and it was purposely released on people. There's people on the other side of the aisle that would have called you a lunatic for that. But that wouldn't make you a lunatic, you know. I never heard of, like, a wildfire starting from Jewish people. I did personally see a video back when the wildfires were really bad. Somebody showed me, like, an infrared video of some type of beam coming down from the sky right where one of the wildfires started. I'm not saying I believe it. I thought maybe it was China. You know, but to say that that's not within human capability, I mean, that would be, I think we'd be ignorant to think that China or global powers don't have the ability to start wildfires with the press of a button through satellites. I mean, I think we're well beyond that capability. Wouldn't you agree with that?
100% no. And listen. Let me give you a handful of things that this woman has said. First of all, if you listen to anything that QAnon conspiracy theories, then you're part of the lunatic fringe. If you believe that Muslims don't belong in government, or 9/11 was an inside job, or the shootings at Parkland, Sandy Hook, and Las Vegas were all staged, or that Zion supremacists are secretly masterminding Muslim immigration into Europe and a scheme to outbreed white people, or that leading Democrat officials should be executed, these are all things that she has said, and that's lunatic fringe ridiculousness. And no, 100%, we as believers of Christ and as people who should keep our minds turned on, These are not things that we should be saying. So no, thank you for your phone call, but no, these are not things that I would agree with. No, these are not things that we should put out there as possible good information. These things make us sound horrible. These things kill our witness. So no, thank you for your call. Back to this. J.D. Vance, like I said, J.D. Vance, we were talking about the City Journal, and Francis and Francis Collins and Anthony Fauci, they're on the hot seat, that much is for sure. And it looks like they've made some major mistakes. The culture war is entering the dumb cycle. Okay, I don't know if you heard about this, but Minnie Mouse is now putting on a pantsuit. What does it say that Mars is making more inclusive M&Ms? I have no idea. And how exactly are you going to care? How much are you going to care if the sexy green one now wears practical shoes? What does it mean for practical shoe wearing Lebesians? I don't know. I don't know what. God bless America, where we have the bounty and we have the comfort and we have the health and we have the peace to spend our days on these kinds of debates. To care what M&Ms are wearing and Minnie Mouse, what she's wearing. Do you understand how great it is to be alive in the United States of America right now? When that is part of the news of the week. Great medical news. The entrepreneur Mark Cuban, also the owner of the Dallas Mavericks last week, launched a new pharmacy, Cost Plus Drugs. And the prices, they're incredible. Leukemia treatment, imatinib, which retails for about $2,500, is sold on Cost Plus Drugs for $17. How? Well, the company says it cut out the middlemen, pharmacies, and now negotiates directly with manufacturers. It doesn't take insurance, but prices like these are less than a lot of people's copays. Pharmacies and hospitals act like a cabal, forcing ever higher costs on consumers, insurers, and taxpayers. So it's great to see someone from the outside enter the broken healthcare market with such a radically lower price point. So kudos. I don't agree with Mark Cuban on everything. I like him on Shark Tank. I don't like him on a lot of his politics. He's a left-of-center guy, but if he can get leukemia drugs that normally retail for $2,500 and people can get them for $17 and do the same thing with other drugs so that people can get things at a non-need of a second mortgage price, good for him, and I can support that. Speaking of scams, beloved woke royalty, Prince Harry and Princess Meghan Markle, survivors of being his and her Royal Highness, received a reported $25 million from Spotify in 2020 to produce a slate of podcasts evaluating underrepresented voices, whatever that means, close quote. So far, we've only made a single 34-minute holiday special. So I don't know what they're doing, but if they're going to get paid $25 million from Spotify, they need to get to producing some content. I'm just not sure who's actually going to listen to that. Spotify, of course, is trying to get a producer to come help. And of course, Page Six got the ad. Spotify removed the job listing. The ideal candidate has experience working with high profile talent and an interest in the intersection of social activism and popular culture. If a common sense reader wants to make a lot of money recording the chirps of the Montecito chicken coop, and their highness, hey guys, this is your moment. Reach out to them. They're looking for your help. Special internet moderated by the Teachers Union. The American Federation of Teachers, Teachers Union, bought a big license for NewsGuard. And it's going to filter and assign disinformation scores to students' search results. I am very curious what the software will rate charter school content. Google the word Catholic school and the kid's computer is going to practically light on fire. Did you hear about Joe Rogan versus Neil Young? Neil Young, many of you probably in this audience know who that is. I have no idea why people like Neil Young. If you are one of the ones who like Neil Young, that just means you're old. But Joe Rogan and Neil Young said basically, if Spotify did not take down Joe Rogan's content off of Spotify, then he was taking all of his music off. And Spotify said, see ya, to Neil Young. Joe Rogan is its biggest draw to Spotify. It took only 2 hours before the audio stream company honored his request and began moving the Neil Young category. Good for Spotify. Carjackings are on the rise. Don't get carjacked. But in a lot of American cities, like 55% up in New York City, 85% up in Philadelphia, 63% up in Minneapolis. Huh. Go figure that one. Defund the police. Who could have ever seen that defund the police would have had this much fallout? NBC put some the footage together in a short segment this week, and it was a real good time to read about how to handle yourself during a carjacking. You might want to Google that, how to handle yourself in a carjacking. And it even got so bad in Philadelphia because this week Philadelphia police put out a tip sheet, tips on how to handle a carjacking. Did you hear Joe Biden this week call a reporter an SOB? Because he had the audacity to ask about inflation, you know, where your goods and services are more expensive than you've seen them in the last 50 years. Well, the mainstream media thought that was hilarious. It's hilarious when Joe Biden calls someone a dirty name. And it was directed at a Fox News reporter at that. So they really enjoyed that. But when Trump said the exact same phrase in the case about NFL players who kneeled for the anthem, oh, the outrage. I mean, it was deadly serious. I mean, democracy was in crisis. MSNBC's MSLSD's Chris Hayes on Trump, when that happened, said, "Today the American president called American citizens who expressed their political views SOBs," except he said the word, of course. And here's what Hayes said when Biden said the phrase to a reporter. Literal, LOL. Oh, the hypocrisy, right? Critical race theory backlash is intense and getting more so. A quick tit-for-tat summary. First, public schools implemented race essentialist curriculums and started getting kids as young as five to start thinking of themselves as white perma-oppressors or black perma-victims. Parents, seeing their children in Zoom classes doing all of this, were shocked, as they should be. Schools and the media erred on the side of deception, denying that any of this was happening at all. And now we're entering the backlash phase. And the backlash, as I promise you, is going to be harsh. Case in point, a Florida school district this week canceled a civil rights history lecture. And a school board in Missouri has now banned four books, including Toni Morrison's The Bluest Eye and Alison Bechdel's Funhome. One reason to fight for common sense liberalism is to be able to have some moral standing and trust when you say that it's important to keep Toni Morrison in the library and that Toni Morrison is not Tima Okun. On another note, there have been a bipartisan consensus around the idea that children cannot handle upsetting or dark content. But that seems to be what was behind a Tennessee school board's removal of the celebrated graphic novel about the Holocaust, Maus, M-A-U-S. They removed it from its curriculum. So you can read all of this through left and right political extremism, each group banning books, or you can read it through the Jonathan Haidt lens. The Harvard psychiatrist, clinical psychiatrist and author of American parents across the political spectrum wanting a world with no sharp corners for their children. So that's sort of a wrap up of this week's what's going on around the news. And what I also want to do at this time is I want to jump into some content. A friend of mine yesterday gave me a pretty big newsletter. It is called the Steve Kirsch Newsletter, and it says in the title of it is, if you're seeing it on screen, he printed it out. It's a pretty big newsletter, full of information and full of reports. And what's interesting about Steve Kirsch, I didn't know who Steve Kirsch was. I asked him who Steve Kirsch was. He didn't know who Steve Kirsch was, and that seemed odd to me because if you're going to use information from a person and they're talking about something as important as coronavirus and vaccines and the government, like, let's find out who Steve Kirsch was. Well, what you find out in the MIT Technology Review is in the early days of the pandemic, as billions of dollars poured into the hunt for novel treatments and vaccines, veteran Silicon Valley entrepreneur Steve Kirsch did what he's always done. He went looking for an underdog. Since making a fortune as the founder of InfoSeek, an early search engine that was the Google of its day, Kirsch has spent tens of millions of dollars fighting humanity's biggest threats. He prefers iconoclastic approaches, whether by direct funding asteroid detection or advocating for nuclear power to combat global warming. By March 2020, he had settled on the idea of searching for COVID treatments in the pre-existing pharmacopoeia. The premise made sense. Most experts were predicting vaccines would take years, while finding helpful drugs with known safety profiles could shortcut the approval process. So with little government funding, available for such work, Kirsch founded the COVID-19 Early Treatment Fund, or CETF. He put $1 million of his own money in, and he brought in donations from Silicon Valley luminaries. The CETF website lists the foundations of Mark Benioff and Elon Musk as donors. And over the last 18 months, the fund has granted at least $4.5 million to researchers testing the COVID-fighting powers of drugs that are already FDA-approved for other diseases. In fact, that work has yielded one promising candidate, the antidepressant fluvoxamine. Other CETF-funded efforts have been less successful, but that's not a surprise, according to researchers who conducted them. The vast majority of trials for any drug end in failure. What has alarmed many of the scientists associated with CETF, though, are Kirsch's reactions to the work he funded, both the successes and the failures. He refuses to accept the results of a hydroxychloroquine trial that showed that the drug had no value in treating COVID, for instance. Instead, he blamed investigators for poor study design and statistical errors. He's also publicly railed against what he claims is a campaign against drugs like fluvoxamine and ivermectin. And according to three members of CETF's Scientific Advisory Board, he put pressure on them to promote fluvoxamine for clinical use without conclusive data that it worked for COVID. Okay, so there's some weirdness that you have a guy who creates, in the very early days of the pandemic, he creates an organization that's basically out there looking for drugs that we already know are safe that can possibly help to fight COVID. That's a bias. So no one expected for Donald Trump to be as successful. Let me just remind everyone of this. We would not have vaccines to take right now if it were not for the unbelievable effort, the Titanic-sized effort of the Trump-led administration to get Operation Warp Speed and get these vaccines to us before the election. Remember, they were approved before the election. We didn't find out till after the election that they were actually ready. And it was the Trump administration that was vaccinating up to 1 million people a day before Biden ever even took office. So let's not forget that. Would Trump have issued a mandate? No. Is Trump the one who gave us the vaccine? Yes. Are the Democrats the ones who said that they would never take a Trump vaccine? Yes. But the fact that they're saying the vaccine is safe now, when Trump said it would be safe, shouldn't that give you a little bit of confidence that they have 180 flipped? I'm just saying. Now, one of the things he's said publicly that more recently, he's adopted extremist positions on COVID vaccines where he alleges they are toxic. I know what Dr. Malone has said, the founder of the mRNA vaccine. I know what Peter McCullough has said, the founder of the mRNA vaccine. Both gentlemen are part of a conservative political group of doctors who are putting out public information. And I'm not saying that there's not organizations like this on the left. What I'm saying is we need to find sources who don't have a right-left political bend and then script public health policy toward that political bend. It is not good. You don't want a right or left doctor performing surgery on you. You want someone who's competent at performing the surgery. He has claimed that one in 1,000 people who have received mRNA vaccines have died as a result. And even the claims that vaccines kill more people than they save. At an FDA public forum, which was first reported on the Daily Beast, is where he said this. And as Kirsch has gone deeper into the anti-vaccine scene, many professional associates have increasingly distanced themselves from him. In May, all 12 members of CETF Scientific Advisory Board resigned, citing his alarming, dangerous claims and erratic behavior over the summer. The conflict reached its most recent startup, M10. Its board told him that if he wanted to remain part of the company, he would have to stop making public anti-vaccine statements. In September, he resigned as CEO and gave up his board seat. So how did a man, once intent on furthering science, become a source of misinformation that undermines the very research he funded? And that's the problem with Kirsch. Now, the other person that you guys are starting to make me feel a little bit sorry for is Bill Gates. Okay, I mean, we're talking about a guy that for all intents and purposes changed the world. I'm sitting here right now, surrounded by his invention. I'm sitting here surrounded by, and you and I are watching things and we are commenting on things using the technology that this man created. And now with the very same technology that this man has created and been one of the leading philanthropists in the world, now Bill Gates is, you know, prime suspect number one. Microsoft co-founder Bill Gates is like the prime suspect now in a hoax to orchestrate the coronavirus pandemic. I have heard it said that Bill Gates has planned the pandemic. In fact, I've seen things where it's like Bill Gates become prime suspect in COVID plandemic. You heard the difference there? This is a plandemic. Now, let me just go through some things here. Okay, some things that hopefully will help you out. Let me extend this out so I can read the full script of everything here. So here we go. We've got an article under the news banner, Bill Gates becomes prime suspect in COVID plandemic. And this was originally posted on social media in January of this year, but it continues to be shared more than 900 and a million times. This thing has been shared on social media. And it's primarily posted by a group called We the People Are Pissed. Okay, I'm sorry for that language, but that's the name of this organization that has over 22,000 members. And so they're the ones that are primarily focused on posting this particular thing. Now, the video that is under this thing here, it removes interviews from their original context. And this is a lack of discernment. If you're sharing this, you are bearing false witness. If you are a Christian, this is the worst kind. This isn't just a spreading of misinformation. You are bearing false witness. You are lying. You are proving, you are showing the world, a lost and dying world, that you have no discernment. Because if you don't stop and check and fact check and know that you know that this is correct, not just take someone's word for it because you trust them, but that you actually check it. But this particular group removes interviews from their original context to give Gates' words a sinister meaning. The first clip, for instance, shows him saying, quote, "So we have to prepare for the next one that will get attention this time," close quote. In conjunction with the fake banner, the quote gives the misleading impression that Gates planned the pandemic. Gates made this statement originally in an interview with the United States Chamber of Commerce Foundation in June of 2020. Okay, the timestamp, I have the timestamps. I can tell you that the 4-minute and 42-second mark of the video, you can watch the whole video, but the interviewer actually asked Gates what his concern for the future were, noting that he had accurately warned of a global pandemic in 2015 when Ebola appeared to be defeated. And Gates responded that the coronavirus pandemic will not be the last, and the world must be better prepared for the next one. That's an argument that's also made by the World Health Organization and multiples of global leaders and many medical experts from both sides of the political spectrum. Then there's a video that then rolls to the second quote where Gates says, quote, "We're taking things that are genetically modified organisms, GMOs, and we're injecting them into little kids' arms. We just shoot them right in the vein," close quote. Now, this clip has been shared before, and it's been contextualized by fact-check organizations like Reuters and other groups. But, like, in short, Bill Gates was discussing GMO food crops. And he said the strongest analogy was with medicines, where people also worried about the side effects. So he's comparing how people are concerned about one just like they're concerned about the other. Not that this is some kind of plan, but the video is not contextualized. There's another clip, and it shows that Gates saying that people don't have a choice about being vaccinated. However, if you go look at the original interview with the Financial Times newspaper in April of 2020, it shows that Gates was not discussing immunization, but explain how governments do not have the option to avoid the pandemic and its impacts. Like, if the United States government said, we're not doing anything, we're not gonna take any precautions, we're not gonna give any guidance, or any government around the world, they would be deemed as an ineffective government. But again, this misleading clip was widely shared last year, and it goes uncontextualized until done so by, unfortunately, fact checkers like PolitiFact. The video then shifts its focus to blog posts suggesting that COVID-19 vaccines alter your DNA by injecting a microchip. And I've got I can give you seven right now, seven articles that debunk the idea that Bill Gates is trying. Did he fill out a patent for microchipped injection technology? Yes. Okay, but some of you have this mark of the beast concern, and so that's what you think, and your theology and your paranoia is driving your ability to think well. Finally, the video alleges that the debunked microchip vaccination works by using an enzyme called luciferase. You heard that? Luciferase? And suggest there is a satanic connection. Hello, Mark of the Beast people. However, none of the available COVID-19 vaccine contain this ingredient, which chemically reacts with the oxidized organic compound luciferin to produce light. The misinformation was explained comprehensively, and I have an article that explains it. Because remember, Lucifer is the Latin. Lucifer means bringer of the dawn or bringer of light. It was the way that Jerome translated the phrase in Hebrew, Haleo ben Shakar, which is the word in Isaiah, I believe, 14 or 28. I think it's Ezekiel 28, where the phrase in English is Haleo ben Shakar. If you have a child named Luke, Luke is a shortened name for the word Lucifer, which simply means bringer of the dawn. That is not Satan's name before he fell. It just means bringer of the dawn. Haleo ben Shakar in Hebrew, Lucifer in Latin, as translated by Jerome. Now, you're not going to like this. I realize you're not going to like this. I'm going to say it anyway. Many of you out there don't like mRNA vaccines, whether it's Pfizer or Moderna, doesn't matter. And the idea of using genetic material to produce an immune response, I got news for you. It has opened up a world of research and potential medical uses that far out of reach of traditional vaccines. Deborah Fuller is a microbiologist at the University of Washington, and she's been studying genetic vaccines for more than 20 years. This particular article talks with her and ask her specific questions, like how long have gene-based vaccines been in development? Because many of you don't want to take this vaccine because you say, oh, this is brand new technology. Well, this type of vaccine has been in the works for about 30 years. Nucleic acid vaccines are based on the idea that DNA makes RNA and that then RNA makes proteins. So for any given protein, once we know the genetic sequence or code, we can design an mRNA or DNA molecule that prompts a person's cells to start making it. When we first thought about the idea of putting a genetic code into someone's body cells, we were studying both DNA and RNA. The mRNA vaccines didn't work well at first. They were unstable, and they caused pretty strong immune responses that were not necessarily desirable. For a very long time, DNA vaccines took the front seat, and the very first clinical trials were with DNA vaccine. But about 7 or 8 years ago, the mRNA vaccine started to take the lead. Researchers solved a lot of the problems, notably the instability, and discovered new technologies to deliver mRNA into cells, which, by the way, don't go into the cell nucleus. And since it doesn't go into the cell nucleus, it doesn't fool with your DNA. And they figured out ways of modifying the coding sequence to make the vaccines a lot more safe to humans. Once those problems were solved, the technology was really poised to become a revolutionary tool for medicine. And that's just when COVID-19 hit. So one of the things that they're really looking forward to, and I'll post the article so you can read the whole thing, is that the discovery that it was really effective in inducing a T-cell response prompted additional thinking about how researchers could use nucleic acid vaccines, not just for infectious diseases, but also for immunotherapy to treat cancer and chronic infectious diseases like HIV and hepatitis B and herpes, as well as autoimmune disorders, and even for gene therapy. Guys, we are entering a golden age of medical technology where diseases that took our grandparents, it took our parents, it took loved ones and young children, it took people from us that we loved, and all of us feel way too early. It took suffering. We're entering a phase where that doesn't have to be the case. I don't know why Jesus followers tend to be so pessimistic. I think it's because they believe that before Jesus comes back, that they believe things have to get worse. I just challenge you to go look for that in the Bible. I want you to think about how in 1910, this is a small thing, but I want you to see how much better things are today. In 1910, you could buy a bicycle for $11.95 from the Sears and Roebuck catalog. And that sounds like a good deal until you realize that the national average for a U.S. blue-collar hourly compensated rate was only 18 cents an hour. That means it took an American blue-collar worker 66.4 hours to earn enough money to buy a bicycle in 1910, just a little over 100 years ago. Today, you can buy a bike at Walmart for about $98. The nominal price of bicycles rose by 720%, but the nominal blue-collar hourly compensation rose by 17,978%, reaching $32.54 per hour. That puts the time price at about 3 hours of work today. If the time price of a bicycle had remained the same between 1910 and 2022, a bike would cost around $2,160 today. Given that the time price fell by 95.5%, the same length of time required to earn enough money to buy one bicycle in 1910 would get you 22 bikes today. Guys, we have a lot of reason to be excited about where we are as a people, where we are as the Church of God, as the people of Jesus. Go out and tell someone that there's really good news, that Jesus is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And we'll see you next time. Thank you for joining the Rock Worldwide Show. Remember to oppose progressivism wherever it rears its ugly head. We'll see you next time.